is the winner of the Kavli Prize in astrophysics. And this focuses on her work at the Lincoln Laboratory at MIT. She's also a Shaw Prize winner this year. It's a wonderful year for Jane Lou. And we will hear about her very interesting research, which is out of this world, on the objects in Neptune's orbit and the research to elucidate early stage planet formation. And I'm sure this will be an education for all of us. Thanks, Jane.
Before I start my scientific talk, I just want to say that I really liked the talk by Jay. That was a wonderful talk. That it made me very happy and also very envious, because you know she's brilliant, but she had many good colleagues who supported her, and she had a wonderful network. From the way she described it, I was very envious because I came from physics and astronomy, and as far as I know, there's no network, support network for women at all. I certainly didn't see any, and it was tough. And I remember giving a seminar at Stanford when I was a postdoc, and I was introduced. And the professors who introduced me said, Jane Lou so-and-so, she won the Annie Jump Cannon Prize. And then he turned to me and he said, that prize is given only to women, isn't it?
Oh my.
And, it just leaves me speechless. And so we were talking about prizes and stuff. So what I asked is, don't give prizes only to women, because it's used against us. We just want to be treated like everybody else. Jade's career story just sounds so wonderful. Mine wasn't as happy, I would say. I was an assistant professor at Harvard, and it wasn't fun. It wasn't fun at all. We would make discoveries, and we would make the front page of the New York Times a couple of times. But nobody said a single nice thing to me from the department. The only people who said nice things were the secretaries. So I'm glad that Jade had a very happy story. And I'm just saying that these things I encountered happens every. I'm not the only one. I'm sure lots and lots of other female scientists ran into them, and we just have to deal with them. And it takes time to change things. So it's just a matter of time, but it's still a lot of work to do. So that's all. All right, so now I'll talk about my work. Okay, well, by 1992, astronomers thought they knew everything there was to know about the solar system. The planets, the satellites, the asteroids, the meteorites, the comets, basically everything you see on this slide. So the inventory of the solar system was thought to be complete. We knew everything. And in fact, if you talk to the typical astronomer, he or she would have questioned why would anybody want to study the solar system at all? Because everything was known. But then in 1992, the discovery of a new population of an object beyond Neptune, called the Kuiper belt, turned this view upside down and showed us that we're very far from understanding our own backyard, the solar system. And my talk today is a story about how the whole thing happened. So the widely accepted theory of planet formation was that everything in the solar system came from a disk of dust and gas swirling around the sun called the solar nebula. We know it was a disk because the orbits of all the planets lie mostly in a plane called the ecliptic plane. And we know this solar nebula contained lots of dust and gas in constant motion. The gas was very tenuous, composed mostly of hydrogen and helium, and there were dust grains everywhere. Then the formation of planets happened in roughly three stages. First, that these dust grains that orbited the sun would randomly collide with each other, and then they stuck, and they grew bigger and bigger. And they stuck together, and they grew to eventually reach the kilometer-sized bodies, which we call planetesimals. And this kilometer size is special because once these objects reach a kilometer size, they can start attracting each other by mutual gravity. And so that encouraged more collisions, and these dust grains stuck together and got bigger and bigger and bigger, and they formed planetary embryos around the size of Mars or Earth. And then finally, in the third stage, the final stage, these planetary embryos would collide with each other, and then that way gave rise to the planets. And that's the planetary formation in a nutshell. So if you consider where our planets are, the planetary system seems to have an end, an abrupt edge at Neptune or Pluto, depending on how you feel about Pluto. But it seems very unlikely that this solar nebula would have a sharp edge at Neptune or Pluto. And this was pointed out as early as 1949 by an Irish scientist named Kenneth Edgeworth. And he thought that, he brought it up that, well, since the solar nebula was unlikely to have a sharp edge, there might be a population of small bodies beyond Neptune. And this idea was brought up again by Kuiper in 1951. Both of these men recognized that these objects beyond Neptune, if they existed, they wouldn't be planet-sized because they didn't have enough time to grow very big. So they would be smaller, maybe the size of a comet. So the region beyond Neptune might be filled with these leftover bodies that never grew into large planets. And they were likely to be icy because they're far away from the sun. And if they were to come into the inner solar system, they would look just like comets. For both Edgeworth and Kuiper, these speculations were basically just speculation. They were not based on any calculation or model. They were guesses, the educated guesses. So their speculations went largely unnoticed, but every so often, theorists would bring up this idea of a trans-Neptunian a comet belt in connection to one particular problem, and that problem is, where do comets come from? So comets are just small icy bodies orbiting the sun, and we identify them by their coma. Do I have a pointer? Is there a slide pointer that can be used? Yeah. At this. Okay. So okay, it doesn't work very well. So the comet is known by its coma, which is this is the fuzzy thing you see around the comet. And this coma appears because when a comet approaches the sun, it's heated enough that the ices on the surface evaporate. And as these newly released gas molecules escape into space, they eject dust particles, so they fill the coma with dust and gas. And these dust particles reflect sunlight, and that's how you're able to see the coma. If you can turn off the coma, then you would just see a kind of a rocky body like that one over there. That's the nucleus of coma Tempo 1. So the presence of the coma tells us immediately two things. First, is the comet is full of ice. The astronomer Fred Whipple calls them dirty snowballs. So this means that it spends most of its lifetime far away from the sun, where it stays frozen. And the existence of the coma also tells us it is constantly losing mass. The dust particles and gas molecule in the coma are complete. Once they escape from the nucleus, they're lost into space. So the nucleus, the comet, when it comes near the sun, is evaporating, it's constantly losing mass. A typical comet, 5 kilometer in radius, like Comet Halley, loses mass at a fast enough rate that it would exhaust its entire body in about 1,000 years when it's near the sun. Granted, when it's far away from the sun, it's not active, so the 1,000 year is a lower limit. But even if it can last a bit more than 1,000 years, there's no way it can last for the 4.5 billion year age of the solar system. Furthermore, the active comets are under the gravitational influence of the planets. And it's very likely that a comet would end its life by either being ejected from the solar system, crashing to the sun, or crashing into a planet, as happened with comet Shoemaker-Levy 9. As you can see in that slide. And this occurs on the order about 500,000 years. So given that an average comet comes to an end one way or another, and at most 500,000 years, why do we still see so many? Maybe they're constantly being made, but we haven't found any place where this can happen. So we have to come to the conclusion that comets formed long ago with the rest of the solar system, and they've just been stored since formation in a cold place. So the question is, where is this storage place? And this question is complicated by the fact that comets' orbits are not all alike. Some have very large orbits, some have very small orbits. So astronomers roughly divided comets into two groups. There's a long-period comets and the short-period comets. The long-period comets, by definition, take more than 200 years to orbit the sun. And the upper left slide shows you roughly what a long-period comet orbit looks like. It's just a highly elongated ellipse. And the point of closest approach to the sun is called perihelion. And you can see there's a star on the right edge. And this picture is not to scale. The true distance to the star is about two times the radius of the orbit. But the point here is that these orbits are so highly elongated, they're so, they stretch out so much that they're not that far from the nearest star. And this picture here shows the orbits of 200 long period comets, and you can see that basically ellipses randomly oriented every which way. So if you could stand outside the solar system looking at them, they would form roughly a spherical cloud. In contrast, the short period comet orbits, as you can see on the right side, have much smaller orbits. They take less than 200 years to go around the sun. You can see the plot, in the lower right-hand plot, you see that's the orbits of a bunch of short period comets. You can see that they're basically clustered around the distance of Jupiter and Saturn. So they're small orbits. They usually, they're mostly confined to the ecliptic system in a plane. And so you can just see, looking at these orbits, you can see immediately that they have the two types of comets have very, very different orbits. So dynamically, they're very different from each other. So where do these things come from? Well, for the long period comets, we already know since 1950. In 1950, a Dutch astronomer named Jan Oort, just by looking at these orbits, he deduced that, well, these orbits are so large that these comets must come from a faraway cloud, 50,000 astronomical units away. And just to remind you, one astronomical unit is a distance between the Earth and the Sun, so 50,000 times further than the Earth. And the cloud where these long-period comets come from are called the Oort cloud, okay? And it's the acknowledged reservoir of the long-period comets. Now, with such a huge diameter, the Oort cloud, the comets at the edge of the Oort cloud are very loosely bound to the Sun, so it doesn't take much to knock them loose. They're highly susceptible to the gravitational tugs of passing stars and the galaxy. So over time, the comets in the Oort cloud have completely been stirred up by passing stars. That's why they have these random orientations. And these passing stars deflect some of them into space and they're lost, and some of them just make it into the inner solar system where we see them. So astronomers have a good handle on where the long period comets come from, but that's not the case with the short period comets. At first, people thought, well, maybe they used to be long period comets and somehow they got captured into these small orbits, but there are many problems with this hypothesis. And so the origin of the short period comets remain unsolved. Every now and then, astronomers, theorists, like the ones mentioned there, would revive this idea of the trans-Neptunian comet belt, proposing that this might solve the problem of the short period comets. But they didn't have any theory, they couldn't say anything with certainty, and that was the way it was for a long time. So around 1987, the guy in the upper right picture, that's Dave Jewett. He was my advisor at MIT at the time, and he began to wonder why the outer region of the solar system was so empty. So you look at this picture, you see the inner solar system, which is the area in that square. That's pretty full. It contains the terrestrial planets, lots of comets, lots of asteroids. But then you go beyond Jupiter, there are only a few giant planets, and then the oddball planet Pluto. So this the emptiness of the outer solar system was quite startling compared to the inner solar system. And he found that puzzling, and so he said, well, there might be two possible explanations. First, maybe the outer regions were really empty because of the gravitational influence of the planets. These giant planets are so good at ejecting anything near them that they basically have cleared out everything in between them. Unfortunately, computers of the 1980s were not powerful enough to confirm the stability of orbits among the giant planets, so this hypothesis was really not verifiable. But it was a possible theory. And second, the other possibility is that this emptiness, which is an artifact of the vast distances of the outer solar system, we can only see solar system bodies by reflected sunlight. So it doesn't take much for a solar system body to become very faint very quickly. If you take an object at one astronomical unit, you move it to 10 astronomical units, it doesn't become 10 times fainter, it becomes 10,000 times fainter. So, and since the brightness of solar system objects decrease so quickly with distance from the sun, so maybe there were objects in the outer solar system, but they were just so faint that they escaped detection. So in 1987, I had just started graduate school at MIT. I was looking for a project to work on, and Dave told me this idea of looking for things beyond the giant planets. Not knowing any better, I went along. But how are we going to find these distant things? We had to come up with a plan. So at first we thought that the best way might be to find occultation of background stars. In an occultation, what happens is that a solar system body goes in front of a star, blocks out the light of the star for just a very short period of time, and then it just moves on. And so if you monitor the star's brightness, as you can see in these lines, those lines there are the brightness of stars that were involved in occultation by asteroids. So you could see that, you know, the brightness would stay constant, and there would be a very dim spot when the asteroid occults a star. And after the asteroid has passed by, the star's brightness returns to normal. And you can see all these lines, all these bright lines, they always have a dim gap in the middle. And so we would look for these gaps in the star brightness to look for our distant objects. But the whippoorwills of Arizona quickly put an end to our occultation strategy. No, the whippoorwill, as you can see in the picture here, they're nocturnal birds, common in Arizona. You almost never see them in the daytime, but they're very vocal at night. We were observing at Kitt Peak. Oops. How do I get full screen on here? Can make it left. So this is what we would hear all night long. So we made a phone call to the Audubon Society. And it was a disappointing phone call because it revealed that occultations were not going to work. The real occultation, let me get this off. This doesn't work very well. OK. The real occultations were just going to be too rare, too short, too similar by occultation by birds. So we had to come up with a new plan. Well, having no predictions of what we were looking for, we decided we would use two methods for our search. First, we would use photographic plates to photograph large parts of the sky. Photographic plates are just glass plates covered with a chemical coating that is light sensitive, and you just expose the plates to light, and then you develop the plates just like you would do with film negatives. And this is what astronomers use before electronic detectors became popular. The advantage of photographic plates is that they're huge, so you can photograph a huge chunk of the sky in one go. And that's a picture on the right. It's from a photographic plate showing the entire constellation of Sagittarius. The plates that we use could cover 25 square degrees in one shot, and that's about the size of 100 full moons. So that's pretty big. In addition to using photographic plates, we would also use CCD cameras on a 1.3 meter telescope to find much fainter things. CCDs, it's a picture, little picture that you can see there, other things inside your camera. They're much more sensitive than photographic plates, about 100 times more sensitive. But they're much smaller, about 1,000 times smaller than plates. And here's a picture of typical CCD image showing just some random stars. And you can see the CCD image covers a much smaller area, but it gives you much better resolution. And you can see much fainter things. So by using plates and CCDs, we thought that we would cover everything. We would get the rare bright object with plates, and then we would see the more abundant fainter things with CCDs. And we would find distant objects by how fast they move. So because distant objects would move more slowly than nearby objects. And since based on this speed limitation, we called our project the Slow Moving Object Project. Every sky survey now is done with CCDs because astronomers have access to enormous CCD cameras. This picture and this guy is holding up the camera for the Pan Stars Telescope in Hawaii. This is the world's largest CCD camera, and you can see how big it is. It has 1.4 billion pixels. And the red dot on it was the size of our CCD when we started doing our work. So, you know, the idea of surveying the sky, which is a tiny camera with no guaranteed telescope time, no support, that was a pretty radical idea at the time. So whether with photographic plates or CCD images, the technique to find moving objects is the same. You look at a sequence of images very rapidly so that anything that moved between the images would stand out. And this process is called blinking, and it's a traditional way to find solar system objects since they move against the background stars. If you have images on photographic plates, then you would use a machine called a plate comparator, and it would line up two plates, like the top two pictures that you see there. And the machine would just switch back and forth between the two plates. Stars and galaxies don't move, And so anything that moved, like solar system object, would be very, very apparent. And these two plates that you see, these are the discovery plates for Pluto, for when Pluto was discovered. And the two red arrows show the position of Pluto as it moved from between one plate to the next. So with these photographic plates, since the data were not in electronic form, a human had to sit there and look at every single star on the plate and just make sure to see if anything had moved. And the whole ordeal was just so painful that after completing the first part of our survey with plates, we vowed never to do it again. And we decided to use only CCDs for the rest of our search. Well, in contrast, blinking is much easier with CCDs, as I'll try to show here. So you can see these are a few frames of, and it shows a Kuiper Belt object, 1999 KR16. And you can see that by blinking, you know, electronically with the help of a computer, it's very clear to see a moving object like that. How do I stop this thing? Okay, there we go. Okay. So when we started our survey, we were unaware of the theoretical work that I mentioned earlier about this hypothesized trans-Neptunian comet belt. And even after we became aware of them, they had very little impact on our work because they made no prediction. So a theory is really no good if it has no prediction. There was no prediction as to how many objects this might lie beyond Neptune, whether they were bright enough to be observed, and whether they were still there. So really, there was nothing to go by. In 1988, Dave moved to the University of Hawaii, and I followed him there, a graduate student. And now we had access to Mauna Kea, a wonderful place for observing. It's also the tallest mountain in the world, if you measure from the bottom of the ocean. And we continue our search for a slow-moving object there. So this slide shows some scenes from the typical life of an astronomer. People think it's glamorous being an astronomer, but it's not. It's mostly many cold nights in a control room on the top of a mountain in the middle of nowhere. Because of the altitude of Mauna Kea, 14,000 feet, and this location in the middle of the ocean, the air above Mauna Kea is exceptionally stable and dry. It's creating a wonderful place for observing. But for humans, it's not very pleasant. The oxygen level at the summit is 40% lower than the level at sea level. And besides being oxygen deprived and becoming more and more dehydrated because it's extremely dry on the summit, there's just a lot of sitting and waiting. You can see waiting for the weather to clear up. You can see in the picture, we do get storms on Mauna Kea, and then there's not much to do. Or do we have long integration, and you do that, as you can see in that other picture. Let's see, should I go back to the previous one? Yeah. Well, our search was not popular. Telescope time committees and funding agencies did not look favorably upon searches for objects that were not predicted by any theory. Even our friends and colleagues kept asking us when we were going to quit and stop wasting telescope time. So we got telescope time any way we could, mostly by stealing from other projects. We would write telescope proposals saying that we would work on a certain project, and then we would take some of that time for this search. And this just went on for years. In the meantime, CCDs kept getting bigger, and so that kept us going. And each time we had a larger CCD, you would think that, you know, this time for sure we're going to find something. And in late summer of 1992, there was a new camera on the telescope, 20 times bigger than what we had originally. And the first time we went observing with this CCD camera, we found the first trans-Neptunian object. It was discovered on August 30th, 1992, 20 years ago. And this slide shows four images, the four discovery images of the object. Our strategy was that we would take three or four images of the same area of the sky spaced out over a few hours. We needed at least three or four images to confirm any detection because there were so many possible artifacts that would mimic a slow-moving object. So we had to, at the time, we had just taken the first two images of the sequence, and we were waiting for the third one. Dave was blinking them on the computer. I didn't like doing it because of the many false alarms that were possible, but he liked doing it. So he was blinking the first two images, and immediately a candidate caught his eye. The candidate had the right characteristics. It was moving slowly. And it was moving in the right direction. It was faint enough that it was unlikely anybody had seen it before, but it was still also bright enough that we knew it was not just noise in our image. But it could have been anything. And after so many years of searching, we hardly dare to believe that it could be real. Then the third image came out, and the object was still there, still the same brightness, still moving in the same direction with the same speed. And then the fourth image came out, and it was still there again. And so by that time, we knew the object was real. So by the end of the night, we knew we had found something far beyond Neptune, far more distant than anything seen before. And based on its speed, we calculated it was 41 astronomical units, far beyond Pluto. And based on this distance, based on how bright it was, we could calculate how big it was, and it was about 250 kilometers across. We had covered 0.7 square degree of the sky before we found this first object. So we knew that if we assume it's a belt all around the solar system in the ecliptic, then we could calculate how many more objects were waiting to be discovered. And this was thousands of objects. And this object came to be known as 1992 QB1. And the population to which it belongs is now called the Kuiper Belt. A lot of people were skeptical about our discovery. This is Brian Marsden. He was then the director of the IAU Minor Planet Center. He's a person that you had to report all new discoveries to in the solar system. He made a $500 bet with us that the object wasn't anything special. It was just a long period comet. And since it was so big compared to a typical comet like Comet Halley, which is like 5 kilometer radius, this thing is 250 kilometers. He said that, if it comes into the inner solar system, it will be the comet of the century. And he lost his bet, but then he paid up. But only 4 years later. So other people told us that we were just lucky, that this object was the only one of its kind, and we had found it, and that's it. And we knew this was absurd, because simple statistics told us well otherwise. But these criticisms didn't bother us much, because we were confident. We found one object, we could find more. And sure enough, we found the next object on the next observing run, and the next one after that, and so on. So by now, more than 1,500 Kuiper Belt objects have been found by people from all over the world. We now know that the Kuiper Belt is a donut-shaped ring of icy bodies, starting at about 30 AU, just beyond Neptune, extending out to about 1,000 AU, an AU, an astronomical unit. It's just a shorter way of saying it. The population contains about 70,000 objects larger than 100 kilometers. If you go down to the kilometer size, there's hundreds of millions, so there's lots of them. So there's a lot of objects out there. So altogether, the total mass is about 0.1 Earth mass. This is much more massive than the asteroid belt in comparison. But this is the current Kuiper Belt is only a shadow of its former self. We estimate that the primordial Kuiper Belt, the original Kuiper Belt, contained at least 100 times more mass. It's about 10 Earth masses. So what does the Kuiper Belt look like? So this plot shows you what the Kuiper Belt orbits look like if you can stand above, high above the solar system and look down on the ecliptic. And immediately what you can, just to let you see, the orbit of Jupiter is included in that mess in the middle. It's hard to see. And this is just a subset of all the 1,500 objects known. And the point of this plot is just to see how diverse the orbits are. You see small, nearly circular orbits. You see big, highly elliptical orbits. So that there are many different orbital types, and they're color coded. And actually, there are four distinct types of orbits in the Kuiper Belt. You can see them a little bit better in the zoomed up view plot on the lower right. So you can see the red orbits, we call these the classical objects, and I'll explain that later. These classical orbits are kept. They have nearly circular orbits, and these nearly circular orbits keep them relatively far away from Neptune. So they're protected from Neptune for most of their lifetime. So we see them as the primordial, the least disturbed of the Kuiper Belt objects. And they're also the blue objects, and these are resonance objects, and I'll explain that in a bit later. And then the big elliptical orbits belong to the scattered group and the detached group, and they're color-coded in green and black. So these two groups have big elliptical orbits, both of them, but there's a difference between them. The scattered objects make close approaches to Neptune, and so they're heavily influenced by Neptune. The other guys, the detached objects, they don't make close approach to Neptune, and we don't know why they get where they got their extreme orbits. Okay. But what we know is that the extreme orbit tell us that the Kuiper Belt witnessed strong gravitational events in the past, and something gave rise to these extreme orbits, but it's not Neptune. So in this plot, it's the same orbit that I've plotted, but here in a different form. So the x-axis is semi-major axis, that just tells you how big the orbit is, and the y-axis is eccentricity, just how elliptical an orbit is. So zero, down here, an eccentricity of zero would be a circular orbit. And you can see all the four different types are much better. You know, so the red dots, the blue dots, the green dots, and the black dots. Ignore the brown dots for now. So here you can see the red dots, the classical orbit. You can see they're clustered in a pretty small region, basically like 40 to 50 AU. And these are the nearly circular objects that I mentioned earlier. We believe they form there. They just stay there the entire age of the solar system. Nothing much happened to them. The most interesting thing about them is that they have a sharp edge at about 50 AU. Nobody knows why. It just beyond, and it's not that they're too faint to be seen, because people have done surveys that should see things way beyond 50 AU, but they did not. So there's a sharp edge at 50 AU, which people call the Kuiper cliff. And their hypotheses to explain the Kuiper cliff, but for sure nobody knows why. And then I talked about the resonant object, the blue, the ones in blue. So you can see the blue dots form kind of vertical lines, and their location and their arrows on top telling you their names, they're called mean motion resonances. And so there's a 3-to-2 resonance, the names are up on top, the 4-to-3 resonance, the 2-to-1 resonance. These are just the three of the more populated ones. There are other resonances in the Kuiper Belt. Now, objects in the resonances have special properties because their orbital period and Neptune's orbital period forms a small number ratio with each other. For example, Pluto is in the 3-to-2 resonance, and I marked it with a P, the blue P. So that means that Pluto completes two orbits around the Sun for every three orbits completed by Neptune. Okay, and then similarly, the object in the 2-to-1 resonance would make one orbit around the Sun for every two orbits made by Neptune. So you can see this geometrical relationship between these objects, the resonance objects, and Neptune. So the question is, well, so what? So what if they have these special orbital relationship with each other? Well, in physics class, you learned that when you have a small periodic force occurring at a natural frequency, called the resonance frequency of the solar system, a tiny, tiny forces add up, giving rise to a big effect. And that's what resonance is. So I'll try to show you that. So I will show an animated movie of this system. This is a well-known extrasolar planetary system called GJ876. And so it's two extrasolar planets going out of a star. Is well known because the two planets are in resonance with each other, 2-to-1 resonance. So the inner planet would make two orbits for every orbit made by the outer planet. Okay, and I will show you that. So when they're all lined up with each other like that, that's called a conjunction, and that happens when they come closer to the star, and that's where they get the little kick from the star, and it's a very, very small kick. Normally, the strongest gravitational influence come from the star. But under special circumstances, like a resonance, that's when the interplanetary gravitational influences come into play. And that's one of the very few times it matters at all, because usually it's the star that dominates. Okay, so I will try to show you what happens when you have this configuration. So here, okay, we'll just start the movie. So you can see the inner planet So outer planet makes one orbit for every two orbits made by the inner one. And then when they, at conjunction, they all lined up. And this happens every orbit of the completed by the outer one. And you can see how the whole system slowly precesses, and that comes from gravitational interaction of the entire system. But that conjunction, that geometrical configuration, repeats again and again and again. And so this little kick just happens over and over and over. And over time, it adds up. Okay, so that's what happens. You can that's a geometrical configuration afforded by having to being in a resonance. Okay, so let me go back. So I just showed you how a resonance comes with special properties, because that geometrical configuration repeats over and over and over and over. The little kick just occurs over and over again at the natural frequency. So Pluto, it being in the 3-2-2 resonance, it comes with all kinds of special properties. You know that the orbit of Pluto actually crosses the orbit of Neptune, but the 3-2-2, the resonance geometry makes sure that when these two bodies cross each other, they never close to each other. So they're always kept far away from each other. So Pluto is completely protected, even though its orbit crosses the orbit of Neptune. And this protection also, it applies to all the other objects in the 3-2-2 resonance, which we call Plutinos, to highlight their similarity with Pluto. And the main thing to notice also is that Pluto blends in perfectly well with the other object in the resonance. If I hadn't marked it with a P, you would never be able to pick it out. So this, more than anything, argues very loudly for Pluto's demotion from planethood. So how did Pluto come to be labeled as a ninth planet? Well, in the early 20th century, astronomers noticed that the position of Uranus deviated from prediction. And they thought, it must be due to the tug of some unseen planet, which they call Planet X. So that guy up there in the upper right, Percival Lowell, hired Clyde Tombaugh in the lower right to search for this Planet X. In 1930, Tombaugh discovered Pluto near the predicted position, and he announced the discovery of a new planet. But it was soon clear that this new planet was rather odd. Whereas the other planets had nearly mostly circular orbits, and you can see in the plot, Pluto's orbit was fairly quite elliptical, whereas the other planet orbits lay mostly in a plane, the ecliptic plane. Pluto's orbit was tilted 16 degrees out of the plane. Its orbit even crossed the orbit of Neptune, so all this was very bizarre behavior for a planet. Eventually, mass estimates show that Pluto was far too small to perturb anything. Its mass is only 0.2% of the Earth's mass, many times less than the Moon. So it turned out that Uranus' deviation from prediction was due to observational errors. They were not even real. So all the predictions regarding Pluto were completely wrong. And Tombaugh discovered Pluto not because of any prediction, but because he was looking where nobody else was. In fact, Pluto was recorded decades before its discovery in 1930, but it went noticed because nobody was looking for a planet. And this story of misdiscovery is not new. Galileo himself saw Neptune, but he didn't pay it any attention. So it delayed Neptune discovery by 200 years. So the moral of the story is people are not very good at seeing things that they don't expect. And so when Pluto's planethood became shaky, there was a huge public outcry against the demotion of Pluto. Some people felt betrayed. For a long time, astronomers told them that Pluto was a planet, and now they're told that Pluto was not a planet. So why would they believe astronomers? Well, the obvious answer is it's the nature of science to change, and it's our job as scientists to tear down old ideas and replace them with new ones that fit observations better, and that's just called scientific progress. Many people, including astronomers, said that demoting Pluto would be very disrespectful. Disrespectful to Tombaugh, to the public, to children, since kids like Pluto. We don't want to hurt people's feelings, especially children's. But science doesn't depend on public's feelings or children's feelings. So the fact is Pluto was just misclassified as a planet, and it's just a large but otherwise unremarkable Kuiper Belt object. So that's basically my entire talk, and I'll just try to say a few words in summary. We started our survey of the outer solar system back in 1987, not because we were searching for this Kuiper belt, but because we wanted to verify that the outer solar system was truly as empty as it seemed. Everybody thought it was empty, but it just seemed not right to us. So we really wanted to verify that. And that's why we started our search. And since our discovery, the Kuiper belt had yielded many surprises, which changed our view of the solar system quite a lot. And it turns out the solar system had a much more exciting past than we thought. And most of it, we don't understand. So we went from having this solar system, which we thought we completely understood. We had the complete inventory tallied up, but now we have this new solar system that whose contents we don't know, whose original configuration we don't know. There are marked signatures of events that we don't understand. So we went from an understood solar system to a not understood solar system. But that's okay, because it just means that there are many more discoveries to be made. That's it.